Today, once we get there, we're going to talk about Leonard Bernstein. And this is, read this up here. And probably the most important thing is that one of the most prodigiously talented and successful musicians in American history. And it's really true. He's a phenomenal, so many facets of his. When I was 18 years old, I drove east and through a series of events, ended up going to Tanglewood that summer, the summer of 1948. And while I was there, Leonard Bernstein was, at that time, was not quite the famous man he became. But in the meantime, I lived in the dormitories, and I vaguely remember this. So here I am having a jam session with Leonard Bernstein playing piano, and there are three pictures. These were in the New York Times Magazine, by the way.
See that young guy with the clarinet?
You're pretty cute.
Pretty cute.
I'm not now?
What's that on top of your head?
The one thing about him is that he has so many facets that he would come in and hang out at the dormitory and play jazz. I don't remember how this came about, but in the meantime, so here's another shot with Bernstein. And there are I recognize a lot of these people. I remember them vividly. One of them was a viola, if I can find him. Well, anyway, I'll show you the other picture.
Do you remember what you were playing?
Probably Body and Soul. Because when I played with Duke Ellington, he said, "What do you want to play, man?" Body and Soul. Because it's an interesting changes, that or Sunny Side of the Street.
Where was this picture taken? In what state?
It was at the Tanglewood Music Festival, where I was as a student. This was in the dormitory. And he just came and hung out. I'll tell you one other story. While I was there that summer, I asked him, would he have a couple of minutes to advise me on my career or what I should do? Vividly remember him saying, get a good education. And I believe that's why I ended up going to Occidental College and getting a Bachelor of Arts degree. So I'm an educated man. Orrin O'Brien is, you're going to be knocked out. I had to be reassured. She's still playing in the New York Philharmonic. She's a bass player. Did we talk about her last week? Okay, so she's 83 years old and still playing. I left 65. Normally around 70, you get out. She is so passionate about what she does that she's still playing at age 83 in the New York Philharmonic. She was hired by Leonard Bernstein. So she left this message on my phone. Let me find it.
Hi, Dick. It's Orrin O'Brien. I got your message. I couldn't call you earlier because I had to teach, and I will be at rehearsal tomorrow, so I can't call you tomorrow morning either. So I just thought I'd leave you a message. Bernstein was above all a teacher. He never stopped studying any score that he conducted. He always loved anything. He wouldn't conduct something unless he loved it. And he would, if I didn't like something on a Tuesday morning, by Thursday morning's dress rehearsal, I would love it because he would have told us all the different ways he thought it was interesting and valuable, and he would convince you. He was so much fun to play with, and he was just a great musician and a great teacher, as you would imagine from his Young People's Concerts, which are all obtainable on video for everybody to see, and also the Norton Lectures, which are wonderful. I have them, too. I have them both audio and the videos, and I think they're just indescribably complex and valuable. Also, I don't know if you know, but they also issued the program that used to be on Sunday afternoons, Omnibus, way before, you know, when we were young teenagers in the 1940s and 50s, he did 8 different programs for them, including What is the Meaning of Jazz, and also the famous Beethoven's Fifth, where he painted the first page of the score on the floor and had musicians stand on the place where their instrument was in the score and explained Beethoven's Fifth to the audience that way. So, you know, he's left such a legacy of things where we can see the way he would be in rehearsal was the way he was in those shows. And so I hope that's enough. And I will call you again. The best time to reach me is Sunday usually because that's our day off. Okay? Nice to talk to you, Dick. Bye.
She really sounds 83 years old.
Yeah. But that she's still playing in the New York Philharmonic string bass. That's, let me tell you, it doesn't happen very often if they stay that long. Any thoughts, questions? Yes?
Did you explain your connection to her, how you came?
My former wife, her mother, and with Ort were good friends. They both lived, didn't she live in Pasadena, Oren? I think she did. They grew up in Pasadena, and I met her 50, 60 years ago, and we've been hung out, but that's how I know her. More. One more short story. When the New York, our orchestra, the Cincinnati Symphony, was getting ready to do a tour, an East Coast tour, and Tommy Shippers was supposed to conduct. That was when he was dying of cancer, and so he could not do the tour. When we got to New York, Lenny Bernstein did the New York concert in Carnegie Hall. He introduced Andre Watts, sort of patted him on top of his head, but did it, and I vividly remember he was doing a Brahms concerto, and I wanted to phrase it a certain way, and I stupidly went up to him and said, I'm thinking of doing this. He said, no, you got to play it the way it's printed. He was wrong, I was right. Huh? Yeah, it would have been much bit more like open and phrased, but I don't think I explained it to him. I should have been more careful about the way I explained it to him. Do you want Margie? Do you want to talk now?
Sure.
Margie's been sort of catching me up on. She's my director. I listen to her. So we've been talking, Leonard Bernstein. So I asked her if she has a few words, many words, just that.
I think it's on. I have been reading a lot about Bernstein. I've seen that picture many times in my life and heard the story of Tanglewood and the story of Get Your Education as advice. But I was struck by, it's amazing to me all the different things that he did from, composing classical pieces for symphony, but also the show tunes, the Broadway shows that he did, and the young people's concerts. But he has a kind of a strong streak of sort of social justice perspective as well that's really impressive. How many of you, you probably all know the story about the party that was had, that he and his wife had at their house and the FBI investigating. You all heard that story? No?
No.
I don't even know that I know it well enough to tell you, except that it was super controversial. They were trying to do something for some people who were, I think, affiliated with Black Panthers, and as someone who was accused falsely, and they ended up being exonerated. But in the meantime, they had this fundraiser at their apartment that ended up they got lots of hate mail. It turned out that I think the FBI had been tracking him for some time, and they orchestrated the hate mail just as kind of to bother Bernstein and his wife. They did their best to find ways to explain why they had done what they had done, and I think they were right, but it took a while to get over it. And his daughter wrote a piece about, just a short thing that I'm going to read to you about it, which was, with the New York 21 episode, the FBI nearly succeeded in discrediting Leonard Bernstein. For a time, my father's stature as a musician was overshadowed by his awful new role as object of trendy ridicule, embarrassing to his acquaintances and infuriating to his fellow Jews. Sadly, we weren't the only ones to suffer. The FBI had deliberately pitted Jews and African Americans against each other, fanning flames of animosity and mistrust that burn to this day. Maybe a few more people now understand what an indomitable visionary he was. All his life, my father resisted the easy tendency to divide the world into us versus them. His embrace of humanity shines through every note of music he composed and conducted. The very existence of music, he believed, was glorious evidence of the human potential for good. That belief was the strength and soul of his life work, and such beliefs are more powerful than any attempt to discredit him. There was just one other thing I was going to share. How many of you have heard what he said after Kennedy was killed? What he said about Kennedy was, of all the political men that I have ever met, he was certainly the most moving and compassionate and lovable. And after Kennedy was shot, he said, this will be our reply to violence, to make music more intensely, more beautifully, more devotedly than ever before. That gets quoted a lot in times of distress, and as his daughter who's writing this piece points out, it's been used a lot frequently, unfortunately.
Weren't they born someone near each other in Brookline, Mass?
Who was they? Bernstein and
Kennedy. Wasn't Kennedy born in Brookline?
I don't know.
He was too,
I don't know. Now, here's something. Any more questions or thoughts? Always open. Look here. What you don't know, and it's something I didn't know, that he was named, appointed professor of poetry, at Harvard in 1973. And he's got a lot of poetry. As it happens, I found this. Can you read that? Let me read it to you. And then I came up with the Chichester Psalms. The Psalms are simple and modest affair, tonal and tuneful, and somewhat square. Certain to sicken a stout John Cager, meaning they're very tonal, they're not modern. With its tonics and triads in B flat major, but there it stands, the result of my pondering, two long months of avant-garde wandering. Avant-garde, he's trying to wander in the avant-garde. My youngest child, old-fashioned and sweet, and he stands on his own two tonal feet. In other words, sort of, I'm not going to say apologizing, but he's saying, I'm not running, I wanted this to be tonal, not avant-garde.
This is part of a longer poem that he wrote for the New York Times. He took a sabbatical from conducting, and during that time he was trying to write a musical, which he and the person he was writing with gave up on after a while. It didn't work out for them. And he ended up writing Chichester Psalms instead. And he wrote a long piece about what he sort of learned and did while he took his sabbatical, and then he wrote this, I guess what he thought about while he was taking his sabbatical, and then he wrote the poem about what he did. And this is just one section of it, which is kind of funny, right? It's kind of a slap at the avant-garde, which was at that time, you know, very, I don't want to say popular, but there was a lot of it going on, and it was controversial, I guess is probably a better word. It's hard to find this. It's in the New York Times archives, but good to see.
I'm looking for Chichester Psalms. I had it here somewhere. Where did I have it? I've lost it. I closed it.
What does avant-garde refer to?
Say it again.
What does avant-garde mean? What does that refer to?
The leading, the kind of music that's a little beyond what we normally, do you want to read?
Yeah. When composers go an extra step, that's progressive. So that's what the word means. Avant-garde means a break with tradition. So when John Cage, who was referenced here and is the leading proponent of avant-garde, 50s, 60s, 70s, and so on, he, for one example, there's a piece called 4 minutes and 33 seconds where the musician, doesn't matter who it is, if it's a pianist, just sits there for 4 minutes and 33 seconds. In the score, there are actually three movements. So that's a conscious break with tradition versus somebody like a Mahler, let's say, who just extended the symphonic form.
Okay. More questions. I'm going to play for you a little bit of Chichester Psalms. In some ways, I think it is somewhat modern and avant-garde. Why won't this move? The expression, his intense emotion in the middle of this. Now, this is the one he wrote the poem about. That was his last child. I think I'm going to play for you now a bit of. He was so prolific in doing all such different kinds of music. You just heard this. Here's a West Side Story with Gustavo Dudamel conducting the Simon Bolivar Youth Orchestra of Venezuela. It's all students. Pretty remarkable. Let me start the beat here first. We know Gustavo, don't we? We talk about him. Thank you. talked about, or how many, when the Cincinnati Symphony did West Side Story playing their own music? Many of you see it? No, I did.
Well, this piece, is my mic on?
Yeah.
it reminds me of a subject regarding Bernstein as a composer, and that is, will his music survive in the repertoire? We can talk about him as a conductor in some ways too, but that's somewhat of a different scenario. These days, let's even say since the end of World War II, when LPs were first manufactured, excuse me, on to today, where you can play CDs, stream, you can do all kinds of ways of getting the music. That's good for composers because there's an extremely wide diversity of ways their music can be heard. You don't have to walk up to a conductor, a pianist, and whoever and say, please play this or that kind of thing. You can do it yourself, put it on YouTube. That's a good thing. The opposite side of that is there is just so much. And in this class, we've sampled pieces by Philip Glass, by composers of electronic music, and also some concert pieces. On the CSO, they had, three or four at least premieres. Where will Bernstein's music be then as time progresses? This piece surely will remain, I would guess. This piece being West Side Story.
Okay.
Both as a concert piece as well as the stage work. Will the Mass, will Chichester Psalms, will any of the other symphonies and so on? I don't know. In one of my writings, I invented a term called fuzzy canon, fuzzy. So there's a canon. There's Brahms, Beethoven, Stravinsky, and so on. Then there are pieces that are kind of, they're solidly in it. Then there are pieces that are kind of around the edge, and they come into it and then go back out of it. I think, except for West Side Story, Bernstein's music will be in that fuzzy part of the canon. So Chichester Psalms, some maybe the Mass, some other pieces. They might, as musical taste evolves, move in with the Stravinskys and the Shostakovichs of the time. But it's just something to think about when we now appreciate very much, I mean, Chichester Psalms performed live just a week ago, and you hear West Side Story all the time, and the Mass was performed recently too. So that's my comment about this music. It's great music. It's a masterpiece. The other pieces, well, I don't mean for quality reasons, for different reasons, they might or might not be included in a class like this one 50 years from now. Now, Dick will still be teaching it then, so it's not that they'll go away entirely.
I'm not teaching, I'm sharing.
We're actually not called teaching, we're called
commentator.
Moderator.
I'm really moderate. Just for fun, here's his second symphony, The Age of Anxiety. I just want you to hear a little bit of it.
Thank you.
interesting. Look at this comment here. When Byron Janis played it. As I said, quite often, in the better performances especially, there are lots of comments that are worth checking out.
Would you have either of you have a comment on his directing style?
I do. Do you?
I do.
I was getting ready to say that almost all of the composers that conducted their own pieces were almost inadequate. I mean, they hadn't studied conducting, they didn't have the physical ability or whatever it is. As you see, and we're going to see more, he was a great conductor. I mean, here's a composer, here's a pianist, here's a teacher of poetry, here's a lecturer, we'll show all the lectures he did. He was good at all of those things, but he was a really good conductor. When you watch him, when you see a conductor and you see the emotions, what he conveys on his face especially, you respond to that as a performer. Does that answer the question?
Yeah.
He was a powerful force. Questions? Yes?
The keyboard was so rapid, I can't imagine a conductor writing every note. Is every note written?
Yes. Right. Yes. And the conductor, by the way, he's a great pianist. I mean, he conducted New York Philharmonic for at least 7 years. He had a career as a piano soloist, playing, writing. And I'm interested that you may be right, that maybe he won't last as a great composer. I mean, he won't be.
No, I wasn't saying that he wouldn't.
Oh, yeah?
I'm just saying that within the context of the tremendous variety of music being composed since the end of World War II, and the access to it equally being expanded, that what will last, say, 50 years from now, I don't know. I'm not saying it won't. I'm just saying that I'm pretty sure West Side Story would.
Got it. Here's a little bit of fun now. This is a piece Bernstein wrote for solo trombone. Elegy for Mippy.
It was composed for his brother's dog named Mippy. He wrote 3-4 of these. I'll talk about it in a moment. Say again.
Did the dog eat his metronome? Is that what he was doing? I mean, he's keeping time.
No, I think.
And I thought, why doesn't he have a maraca taped to the other one so he can kind of complete it?
A maraca.
We can't ask him now.
We can't.
Sorry.
We can't. Sorry. Oh, but
no.
One thing I'm almost sure. In the trombone part, it has a paragraph saying, Before you start playing, you think of the tempo you want to play, and then you beat your foot as a drum. It's something like that. That wasn't impromptu. It was, he was told to do that.
I expect that takes some practice to get that.
I think you're right. Yeah, that's not easy to do.
Right. He wrote three of these, Elegy for Mithy. One, which is for French horn and piano. This one for solo trombone. The third one for tuba and piano. And then he wrote one kind of like this, called Rondo for Liffey, which is for trumpet. He liked writing for his friends, obviously for his brother's dog, and he also had kind of a goofy sense of humor sometimes, and perhaps it comes through in this. It just indicates an aspect of his, not counteracts, but adds to the intellectualism of so much of what he did, and then this playful stuff. All these pieces written in the 40s.
Thoughts? Here's another side of them.
Maybe that's what we should call this kind of music instead of classical. We should call it exact music, because there's only one way it can be played, and that way has been told us by the composer himself. But on the other hand, if we take a popular song like, oh, for instance, I Can't Give You Anything But Love, Baby, there's no end to the ways in which it can be played. It can be sung by a chorus, or by Louis Armstrong, or by Maria Callas, or by nobody. It can just be played without any words by a jazz band, or a symphony orchestra, or a kazoo, slow or fast, hot or sentimental, loud or soft. It just doesn't matter. It can be played through once or repeated 15 times in any key, even with the chords underneath changed. Even the tune itself can be changed and improvised on and fooled around with. For instance, the way the tune goes on the printed sheet music is like this. Pretty dull, isn't it? But when Louis Armstrong sings it, then it begins to sound something like this. I can't give you anything but love. Baby, baby, baby. That's the only thing I plenty of. Or if a cool progressive cat is playing it on the piano in Birdland, it might sound something like this. Unrecognizable. Or if it were sung by, let's say, the Fred Waring Glee Club, it would have a completely different sound. It goes something like, I can't give you anything but love. Something like that. But the main thing about all this is that none of those ways is wrong. Each way seems right for those particular performers who are doing it at the time, and right for the particular occasion at which they're doing it, whether it's for dancing or on a television show or at Birdland. There isn't any one way it has to be done, which means that it's not exact music. It doesn't have to be done exactly the way the composer wrote it. In fact, what's even more important is that popular songs definitely should not be done the way the composer wrote it, the same way all the time. Just imagine how deadly dull it would be if the only way you ever heard I Can't Give You Anything But Love was the way the sheet music reads. It would be awful. And the same thing goes for full.
This is only one of his young people's. There's a whole series of those. Remarkable. I remind you, if you Google Leonard Bernstein, you'll come up, Google it or go to YouTube and put Leonard Bernstein in. You get piles of videos of all kinds of things. The young people's concerts, the lectures, it's remarkable. Thoughts? Questions?
I had many years ago, it may still be in my basement, but I may have though the Young People's Concerts in seven in an album of 78 records.
Oh my gosh. Oh my gosh. It must have been a thick album.
Yeah.
Yes.
I wonder how many of us have watched this.
How many of you watch the Young People's? Well, again, I beg you.
Wonderful.
If you have, they're good for us. They're young people. They teach us. And all of his lectures. So I'm going to go to something now that's...
The question in front of me.
Yes. Oh, there's a question.
I just had a comment. You were talking about the way people conduct. And I'm going back, I keep going back to Dudenmell, and I see that energy in Bernstein transmitted through him, but then it goes into the, I don't know if anybody else picked it up or not, the people who were playing West Side Story were so focused, they had attitude, what I call attitude. And the attitude seemed to be coming from Bernstein through Dudenmell and then to them. And so instead of just a tune on the horn, they were, you know, and they were so focused. It was very sharp, and I love the way that whole thing translated for West Side Story.
Again, you're saying it, what, as a member of the orchestra, sitting in the orchestra, when you see that energy coming from the conductor, and that's what makes the orchestra play great. That's where you've heard the story. A conductor like that gets to a average orchestra, and all of a sudden becomes a great orchestra because of what he did. I want to do this for you now. This is Leonard Bernstein on the Beethoven Ninth. You want to tell them about this performance?
Are you sure that's the right one?
Well, this is just him talking. Should I let him talk first and then you talk, or you talk? You talk.
Him, because maybe he'll say what I would say.
No, this is very short. This is the end of the conversation.
Forgive me for getting carried away. I had meant to stick to the subject of dates and of Beethoven. But it is all one. Beethoven is struggle, the struggle for peace, for fulfillment of spirit, for serenity and triumphal joy. He achieved it in his music, not only in his Ninth, but in all his symphonies, and in his quartets and piano sonatas and trios and concertos. Somehow it must be possible for us to learn from his music by hearing it. No, not hearing it, but listening to it with all our power of attention and concentration. Then perhaps we can grow into something worthy of being called the human race.
In 1989, the Berlin Wall fell. And to commemorate that, actually, right at the time, it didn't happen overnight, and they knew it was going to happen, and they knew when. They wanted to have a major event right at the wall. And there's a theater that had been damaged during World War II, but by 89 had been restored. And they had a performance of Beethoven's Ninth, Bernstein conducting, and it was a pickup orchestra. There were musicians from Germany, the United States, the UK, and Russia. And the soloists were likewise from different places. It was broadcast live on satellite, and more than 20 countries were able to receive it in real time. It's one of the most famous performances of any in the 20th century. And we're going to hear maybe all of the last movement. He changed the text.
You can't do it. It's too long for that. But I'll explain in a minute. Go ahead.
He changed the text from Freude to Freiheit. So from joy to
freedom.
He changed that.
If you see this here, it says Ode to Freedom, where it's always been known as the Ode to Joy, but he changed the word to freedom.